Welcome to this evening's program. My name is Denise Jorgens, and I'm the Director of Programs and External Relations here at International House. International House is pleased to partner with the Office of the President and the Office of the Provost, as well as a wide range of other university departments, in particular the Department of History, to host this evening's program. Tonight's program is co-sponsored with our Global Voices program, which presents prominent speakers and organizes roundtable discussion groups and special interest conferences and seminars. Additional information about programs at International House is available on the entrance area as you came in. We hope to see you here at many other events. Thank you all for coming.
Ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of the President, the Provost, the Division of Social Sciences, the Division of Humanities, the College, the Committee on Jewish Studies, the Program in Poetry and Poetics, International House Global Voices Program, Critical Inquiry, the Franke Institute, the Center for European, East European and Russian and Eurasian Studies, the Russian Studies Workshop, the Department of History, the Department of Slavic Languages and Literatures, it's my honor to welcome Yevgeny Yevtushenko.
I would like to begin with one my poem, which I wrote in the pretty difficult moment when one of my very well planned tours for 27 American universities was unexpectedly forbidden. I had very bad mood, honestly saying. Not because of me, because of Professor Albert Todd, who was organizing this trip, and he invested so many energy and his hopes. So I felt like a man being not guilty personally in cancellation of this trip. I just feel guilty as a friend. A poetry, I think, like art probably in general, it's a kind of liberation, our liberation from our dark thoughts. If you will find, of course, strength in yourself to believe in the future, not to lose even hard moments of your life. And I wrote this one poem, which liked very much old American friend of mine, Allen Ginsberg. And he recited many times this poem in our common performances. So I apologize. I will read this poem in English with inevitable Siberian accent. Anyway, how many people here in this hall knows Russian? This sort. Yes. Okay, so I will read in Russian too. This is wonderful, in this wonderful company, these two young men, guys who were working with me till the 3 a.m. last night. So forgive me my inevitable accent. I would like to be born in every country, have a passport for them all, to throw all bloody boring foreign officers into panic, be every fish in every ocean and every dog in the streets of the world. I don't want to bow down before any idols or play at being a Russian Orthodox Church hippie, but I would like to plunge deep into Lake Baikal and surf a snorting somewhere. Why not in the Mississippi? In my damned beloved universe, I would like to be a lonely weed, but not a delicate narcissus, kissing his own mug in the mirror. I would like to be any of God's creatures, right down to the last mangy hyena, but never a tyrant, or even the cat of the tyrant. I would like to be reincarnated as a man in any image, a victim of Paraguayan prison tortures, a homeless child in the slums of Hong Kong, a living skeleton in Bangladesh, a holy beggar in Tibet, a black in Cape Town, but never in the image of Rambo. The only people whom I really hate are the hypocrites, pickled hyenas in heavy syrup. I would like to lie under the knives of all the surgeons in the world, be hunchbacked, blind, suffer all kinds of diseases, wounds and scars, be a victim of war or a sweeper of cigarette butts, just so a filthy microbe of superiority doesn't creep inside. I would not like to be in the elite, nor, of course, in the cowardly herd, nor be a guard dog of that herd, nor a shepherd sheltered by that herd. And I would like happiness, but not at the expense of the unhappy. And I would like freedom, but not at the expense of the unfree. I would like to love all the women in the world, and to be a woman too, just once. Men have been diminished by Mother Nature. Why couldn't you give motherhood to men? If an innocent child stirred below his heart, men would probably not be so cruel. I would like to be man's daily bread, say, a cup of rice for a Vietnamese woman in mourning, cheap wine in a Neapolitan worker's trattoria, or a tiny tube of cheese in orbit round the moon. Let them eat me. Let them drink me. I would like to belong to all times, shock all history so much that I would be amazed what a smart aleck I was. I would like to bring Nefertiti to Pushkin on a troika. I would like to increase the space of a moment 100-fold so that in the same moment I could drink vodka with fishermen in Siberia and sit together with Homer, Dante, Shakespeare, Tolstoy, drinking anything, except, of course, Coca-Cola. Dance to the tom-toms in the Congo, strike at Renault, chase a ball with Brazilian boys at Copacabana Beach. I would like to know every language, like the secret waters under the earth, and do all kinds of work at once. I would make sure that one Yevtushenko was merely a poet. The second, an underground fighter, I couldn't say where, for security reasons. The third, a student at Berkeley. The fourth, a jolly Georgian drinker. And the fifth, maybe a teacher of Eskimo children in Alaska. The sixth, a president somewhere, modestly say, in Sierra Leone. The seventh would still be shaking a rattle in his stroller. And the tens, the hundreds, the millions. For me, it's not enough to be myself. Let me be everyone. I shall be in 1,000 copies to the end of my days, so that the earth buzzes with me, and computers go berserk in the world census of me. I would like to fight on all your barricades, humanity. Dying each night like an exhausted moon and resurrecting each morning like a newborn sun with an immortal soft spot, fontanelle on my head. And when I die, a rebellious Siberian Francois Villon, do not lay me in the earth of France or Italy, but in our Russian, Siberian earth, on a steel green hill where I first felt that I was everyone. Thank you. Now we are going to read Russian English. Or English Russian, I'm sorry.
Sleep, my beloved. The salty spray glistens on the fence. The wicket gate is bolted tight. And the sea, smoking and heaving and scooping the dikes, has sucked itself into the salty sun. Sleep, my beloved. Don't torment my soul. Already the mountains and the steps are falling asleep, and our lame dog, shaggy and sleepy, lies down and licks his salty chain. And the branches are murmuring, and the waves are trampling, and the dog and his day are on the chain. And I say to you, whispering, and then half whispering, and then quite silently, sleep, my beloved. Sleep, my beloved, forget that we quarreled. Imagine we are waking. Everything is new. We are lying in the hay, we sleepy heads. Part of the dream is the scent of sour cream from somewhere below, from the cellar. Oh, how can I make you imagine all this, you so mistrustful? Sleep, my beloved, smile in your dream. Put away your tears, go and gather flowers, and wonder where to put them, burying your face in them. Are you muttering? Tired, perhaps, of tossing? Muffle yourself up in your dream and wrap yourself in it. In your dream, you can do whatever you want to. All that we mutter about if we don't sleep. It's reckless not to sleep. It's even a crime. All that is latent cries out from the depths. It is difficult for your eyes. So much crowded in them, it will be easier for them under closed eyelids. Sleep, my beloved. What is it that's making you sleepless? Is it the roaring sea, the begging of the trees, evil forebodings, someone's dishonesty? And maybe not someone's, but simply my own. Sleep, my beloved. Nothing can be done about it. But no, I am innocent of that accusation. Forgive me, do you hear? Love me, do you hear? Even if in your dream, even if in your dream. Sleep, my beloved. We are on the earth, flying savagely along, threatening to explode, and we have to embrace, so we won't fall down. And if we do fall, we shall fall together. Sleep, my beloved. Don't nurse a grudge. Let dreams settle softly in your eyes. It's so difficult to fall asleep on this earth. And yet, do you hear, beloved? Sleep. And the branches are murmuring, and the waves are trampling, and the dog and his day are on the chain, and I say to you, whispering, and then half whispering, and then quite silently, sleep, my beloved.
In France, they say that translation is like a woman If it's faithful, it's not beautiful. If it's beautiful, it's not faithful. But I don't think that's completely true about women or translations. It's a beautiful translation, but there's one difference that you always will feel. Because unfortunately, if we'll compare the English dictionary of rhymes with Russian dictionary of rhymes, it's a big difference. Last Russian rhyming dictionaries like this. And so, unfortunately, it happened that many rhymes in English, they are just overused. And that's why probably it's even naturally, most of serious poets now in English, they are trying not to rhyme or use rhymes just for funny poems, for lyrics, for musicals, and so on. But in Russian, it's a different situation. I could say it's probably inevitable even for Russian language. We couldn't predict what could happen after many years. Pity a little bit, because rhyme has charm. It keeps poems, it's easier to remember poetry with rhymes. It's like little bells, rhymes. They help you remember all text. But it's inevitable. It's not laziness of translators. It's a good translation. An Australian classic friend of mine who passed away, unfortunately, Jeffrey Dutton. It's a good translation. But I hope you feel difference now between translation and Russian original, which something is inevitably lost. Sleep, my beloved, in Russian, любимая, beloved, спи, sleep, любимая, спи. Соленые брызги блестят на заборе, калитка уже на запоре, и море, дымясь и вздымаясь, и дамбы долбя, соленое солнце всосало в себя. Любимая, спи, мою душу не мучай, и пес наш хромучий, немножко дремучий, ложится и лижет соленую цепь. И море всем топотом, а ветви всем ропотом, и всем своим опытом пес на цепи, а я тебе шепотом, потом полу шепотом, потом уже молча, любимая, спи. Бормочется, видно, устало ворочаться, ты в сон завернись и окутайся им. Во сне можно делать все то, что захочется, все то, что бормочется, если не спим. Не спать безрассудно и даже подсудно, ведь все, что подспудно, кричит в глубине, глазам твоим трудно. В них так многолюдно, под веками легче им будет во сне, любимая, спи. Что причина бессонницы, ревущее море, деревьев мольба, дурные предчувствия, чья-то бессовестность, а может, не чья-то, а просто моя, любимая, спи. Ничего не попишешь, но знай, что невинен я в этой вине. Прости меня, слышишь, люби меня, слышишь, хотя бы во сне, хотя бы во сне, любимая. Спи, мы на шаре земном, свирепо летящем, грозящем взорваться. И надо обняться, чтобы вниз не сорваться. А если сорваться, сорваться вдвоем, любимая. Спи, ты обид не копи, пусть соники тихо в глаза заселяются, так тяжко на шаре земном засыпается. И все-таки слышишь, любимая, спи. И море всем топотом, и ветви всем ропотом, и всем своим опытом пес на цепи. А я тебе шепотом, потом полушепотом, потом уже молча. Now we are going to read with wonderful Margaret one my poem, which I thought is impossible to translate. But sometimes everything what happens in reality is so-called untranslatable poems. It's reverse. It's beautifully translated. My friends, English friends, Simon Franklin and Arthur Boyers, they were digging. Many. This poem based on the ancient, almost forgotten names of Russian villages, and being honest, some of these names I invented. So they confessed me afterwards, after this beautiful translation, which is probably much better than original, anyway, not worst, that also they used some ancient names of English villages, and they also permitted themselves the same privilege of freedom in translation. So it's beautiful, charming. I hope you'll enjoy. We will read it stanza by stanza. Metamorphosis.
Childhood is the village of Rosie Cheekly, little silly, clamoring over him, leapfrog Morton, going towards Cruelidge through unmaliciousness and clear visionden.
Детство — это село краснощекого, несмышленного, всеизлазого, скок-поскокого, чуть жестокого, но беззлобненно, но чистоглазого.
Youth is the village of Hopeworth, Expansion Grove, Seduce Hall, and, well, if it's a bit like Foolmouth, it's all the same promising.
Юность — это село Надеждина, Нараспашкина, Обольщанина. Ну, а если немножко невеждина, все равно оно... Обещанина.
Maturity is the village of Divide Ways, either Involvement Haven or Hidewell, either Coward's Bridge or Brave Water, either Crooked Wood or Just Field.
Зрелость — это село Разделово, либо Схваткина, либо Пряткина, либо Трусова, либо Смелого. Либо Криводина, либо Праводина.
Old age is the village of Tired Head. Understand more, little reproach, forget fast, overgrown end, and God keep us from it, Lonelybury.
Это село усталого, понимаева, неупрекова, забывалого, зарасталого. И не дай нам Бог одиноко. Thank you. So now we are, we'll try to recite one poem line by line. Very arrogant experiment.
I love you more than nature.
Я люблю тебя больше природы.
Because you are nature itself.
Ибо ты как природа сама.
I love you more than freedom.
Я люблю тебя больше свободы.
Because without you, freedom is prison.
Без тебя и свобода тюрьма.
I love you incautiously.
Я люблю тебя неосторожно.
Like an abyss, not a groove.
Словно пропасть, а не колею.
I love you more than possible.
Я люблю тебя больше, чем можно.
And more than impossible, too.
Больше, чем невозможно, люблю.
I love you timelessly, tirelessly.
Я люблю безоглядно, бессрочно.
Even being drunk, being rude.
Даже пьянствуя, даже грубее.
I love you more than myself.
И уж больше себя, это точно.
I love you more than only you.
Даже больше, чем только тебя.
I love you more than Shakespeare.
Я люблю тебя больше Шекспира.
More than all bookish wisdom.
Больше всей на земле красоты.
Even more than all music.
Даже больше всей музыки мира, ибо книга и музыка ты.
Because you are music and book. I love you more than the glory of fame.
Я люблю тебя больше, чем славу.
Even glory of future times.
Даже будущие времена.
I love you more than my motherland.
Чем заржавленную державу.
Because my motherland is you.
Ибо родина ты, не она.
Are you unhappy? About what do you complain?
Ты несчастна. Ты просишь участия.
Don't bother God with your prayers and petitions.
Бога просьбами ты не гневи.
I love you more than happiness.
Я люблю тебя больше счастья.
I love you more than love.
Я люблю тебя больше любви. Браво! After this poem, it was beautiful, read by beautiful. So I a little bit. I'm sorry, I told you I'm unexpected man. Why is I beating you? So, and I would like to read special poem which I didn't plan to read. Now I don't know. I won't. It's about the Cold War time, my first experiences in America. When I've been 1960 for the first time, and two girls, they in the Kansas book fair, they got close to me, and they were brainwashed about Russia like I was brainwashed about America. But that time was where Fidel Castro was very popular amongst Americans, young Americans, amongst Russians, and so. One of them on her beautiful breast, she had button with the Fidel Castro, and I have two, the same button, the same Fidel. So it made us closer. So she asked me, may I touch you? I said, why? I was a little bit scared because I was instructed that contacts, especially these female creatures, are dangerous. I could be provoked, it could be filmed, and so I could be discredited, recruited. I don't know, I was slightly disappointed that nobody was even trying to recruit me in America. Because you have a lot of troubles with your own writers. So, to get it to Schenker was too much, it would be too much. So, and So that I will read this poem. You see how I'm a difficult partner. So it's called Tsunami. So I escaped from our tourist group for a weekend. With her, of course. Now it will be, in we, she said, I would like to give you the best what I know in America, San Francisco. She admired San Francisco. And we spent 2 days in San Francisco. I still love this wonderful city. Now, this is a little chapters, three, but little chapters. It's not novel, you know. So the first chapter, the morning, it shows how I was. When it was time for me to leave hotel, I was flying back to New York to join our tourist group flying back in Moscow. It was so, I afraid what it was to wake up her. She was so beautifully sleeping. So, and afterwards I'll come back to what we were doing in San Francisco. When the night, thread of love, first little chapter, when the night, exhausted from passion, slowly began to be reborn as morning, between our separated lips, linking them again, suspended baby's thin, sweet saliva, shining as a silver veined thread. And this thread didn't want to tear apart, two bodies transformed into one. This thread sparkled like a lonely strand, remembering King Solomon and his beloved, who after tireless love playing, understood that this split would be inevitable. We were saving the same distance between our lips, afraid of the smallest motion, hopelessly trying to slow down the dying of the weak, transparent thread, uniting our stunned lips, carefully exhaling trembling air. Second chapter, Gringa. It happened in San Francisco, where we were hiding in a little motel from the panoptic eyes of the CIA and KGB. Both of us in our early 20s, both criminally young, both full of boredom with talking heads on the TV screens, both in the holy fever of love, in the midst of the Cold War, an incorrigibly curious Siberian boy and a joyfully dissident American girl squeezing each other in a very tender class struggle. I called you Gringa. Between our lips danced crazy sparks. We were high, not on drugs, but on the speeches of young Fidel, on the beautiful face of not yelled kill Commandante Che, and of course on the cha-cha-cha. Oh God, how we both wanted to immigrate. Not to any country, because all of them are stuffed with the same talking heads on the TV screens, but to immigrate only into this charming crotch motel, into this stormy bed, squeezing each other like revolutionary rifles and writing inflamed verses into leaflets of our beloved Barbuda. Oh, how warm was our Cold War. Then we could not imagine Castro getting older, and we could not imagine the collapse of USSR. We predicted the end of capitalism, and we swore to it, chewing with pleasure non-socialist camembert full of capitalist mold. In the morning, happily not lifting a finger, we were floating on our blessed laziness like on the slow raft, caressed by shy waves, and all revolutionary legends and myths were trembling in sunrise like a golden dust over the risky head of my leftist Sulamith. Now, in the USA, some clever leftists make good profits on the Hollywood market. Now, in Russia, those who had sent tanks against the Prague Spring paradoxically call themselves leftists. Stop, history. Where are you going? The new breed of leftists in Moscow, wearing shining mink hats, are sitting in stretched limos, long and dark, as the hopeless hopes of the Russian people. What is left for us in their left? For you to hear Bush? For me to hear Putin? Where are you, my beloved lefty, my Salome broken by history? And third, final chapter, shrouds. Is there a moon over the world or a lamp in someone's hand? For seeing in the starless darkness all the horror of the dead beaches of Thailand and the shrouds on the earth laid end to end. You ask me, let's sweep politics out of our heads. Let's go somewhere. Why not to Thailand? Even for 1 week, even for a weekend. And your girlish look was heard by no answer. Inside one century, we haven't seen each other for many centuries. But during the tsunami, I was startled. I imagined that you flew to Thailand, searching for death, saving on your lips that silver trembling thread of love. Why did the tsunami happen? Maybe because Castro, our hero from long ago, when leaving the shaky pedestal of the stage, stumbled and for the first time fell down, understanding that he is just an old man. And all of us in different countries, in your and mine, now stumble over the dead bodies of the people killed by us. All of us sleep on the blood in the streets where no one ever invited us. But the revenge of Mother Nature could not to be pinpointed, because vengeance can't be precise and vindictive outrage waters have no time to read any passports. I enter into the TV screen. I walk alone on the beach, mumbling this helpless poem. And I caress with my eyes white silent shrouds, as if you are inside one of them. So we will read in three voices one poem which liked very much our great composer Shostakovich, what he created his oratorium based on this poem. It's execution of Stepan Razin. Stepan Razin was kind of Russian Robin Hood, hero of many folk songs, poems. And he was executed on the Red Square. He was a great peasants leader. He was a leader which didn't repent despite of all terrible torturements. And this piece, I use about 20 different, you probably will feel 20 different rhythms based on the Russian folklore. Okay, that's difficult. Okay, I'll check order of pages, okay? Fufu.
The execution of Stenka Razin. In Moscow, the white-walled capital, a thief runs with a poppy-leaved soap down the street. He is not afraid of being lynched today. There isn't time for loaves. They are bringing Stenka Razin.
The Tsar is milking a bottle of mead before the Swedish mirror. He squeezes a pimple and tries on an emerald seal ring. And into the square, they are bringing Stenka Razin.
Like a little barrel following a fat barrel, a baby landlord rolls along after his mother, gnawing a bar of toffee with his baby teeth. Today is a holiday. They are bringing Stenka Razin.
A merchant shoves his way in, flatulent with peas. Two buffoons come rushing at a gallop. Drunkard rogues come mincing. They are bringing Stenka Razin.
Old men, scabs all over them. Hardly alive, thick cords round their necks, mumbling something, dodder along. They are bringing Stenka Razin.
And shameless girls also, jumping up tipsy from their sleeping mats with cucumber smeared over their faces, come trotting up with an itch in their thighs. They are bringing Stenka Razin.
Как в стольной Москве! Да белокаменной! Вор по улице бежит с булкой маковой. Не страшит его сегодня самосуд. Не до булок, Стеньку Разина везут. Царь бутылочку Мальвазии выдаивает. Перед зеркалом свейским прыщ выдавливает. Примеряет новый перстень изумруд. И на площадь Стеньку Разина везут, как за бочкой бокастый бочоночек, за боярни катит боярчоночек, леденец зубенки весело грызут, нынче праздник, Стеньку Разина везут. В струпе все едва живые старцы с вервием на вы, что-то шамкая ползут, Стеньку Разина. И срамные девки тоже под хмельком вскочив с рогожи, огурцом намазав рожи, шпарят рысью в ляжках зуд. Стеньку Разина везут.
He is silent, all covered with the spit of the mob. He does not wipe it away, only grins wryly, smiles at himself. All right then, spit, spit, spit! After all, it's a free show. Good people, you always spit at those who wish you well. The Tsar's scribe beat me deliberately across the teeth, repeating fervently, decided to go against the people, did you? You'll find out what it's against. I held my own, without lowering my eyes. I spat my answer with my blood. Against the landlords, true. Against the people, no. I have sinned in this, that in the world of evil I was a good idiot. I sinned in this, that being enemy of serfdom, I was something of a serf myself. I sinned in this, that I thought of doing battle for a good Tsar. There are no good Tsars. Fool, Stenka, you are perishing for nothing.
Он молчал, не утирался, весь оплеванный толпой, только горько усмехался над собой. Ладно, плюйте! Все же радость задарма, вы всегда плюете, люди, в тех, кто хочет вам добра. Дьяк мне бил с оттяжкой зубы, приговаривал. В конце концов, как ты, Стенька, что с тобой? Видно, не из молодцов.
But over the shouts, pig faces and ugly mugs of tax collectors and money changers. Like a light through the fog, Stenka saw faces. It's worth bearing it all without a tear to be on the rack and wheel of execution if sooner or later faces sprout threateningly on the face of the faceless ones.
And calmly, obviously he hadn't lived for nothing, Stenka laid his head down on the block, settled his chin in the chopped-out hollow, and with the back of his head gave the order, "Strike, axe!" The head started rolling, burning in its blood, and hoarsely the head spoke, "Not for nothing."
И сквозь рыло ряжки Хари целовальника менял, словно блики среди хмари, Стенька лица увидал. Стоит все терпеть бесслезно, все стерпеть в конце концов, если рано или поздно проступают лица грозно у безликих на лице. И спокойно, не зазря он, видно, жил, Стенька голову на плаху положил, подбородок в край изрубленный упер и затылком приказал: «Давай, топор!» Покатилась голова, в крови горя, прохрипела голова. Не зазря.
But heavy from its blood-wet place of execution, there, where the poor were, the head threw looks about like anonymous letters.
Bustling, the poor trembling priest ran up, wanting to close Stenka's eyelids, but straining, frightful as a beast, the pupils pushed away his hand.
On the Tsar's head, chilled by those devilish eyes, the crown began to tremble, and savagely, not hiding anything of his triumph, Stenka's head burst out laughing at the Tsar.
Суетясь, дрожащий попик подлетел, веки Стенькина закрыть он хотел, но, напружившись, по зверье страшны, оттолкнули его руку зрачки. На царе от этих чертовых глаз зябка шапка Мономаха затряслась, и жестоко, не скрывая торжества, над царем захохотала голова. Thank you. Now, okay, this one is mine. Now, this is another hero of history. Hero of Cold War for me. A great, great American singer and actor, Paul Robeson. He was one of the heroes of my childhood. Paul Robeson, I met him and he, together with many children, when he organized for free concert for Russian children in Moscow Square in 1947 in Moscow. It was anniversary of Pushkin. Very interesting what I found afterwards in archives. Stalin's remark on the text of Paul Robeson's speech in this anniversary. Stalin cut one paragraph of Paul Robeson speaking about his African origin, Pushkin's African origin, Ethiopian origin. So, and it was written by Stalin. And let him to say it, but do not translate. So that was Stalin's internationalism. So, but Probson for this trip in 1947 was covered with mud by American right-wing press. They called him communist agent, despite he never been member of communist party. He was sympathizer, that's a different thing. But I think it was just feeling of social protest and nothing else. And one thing, I've seen this film when Robson's admirers were going after his return from the Soviet Union. Some so-called official patriots, they were destroying cars of his fans with baseball bats. It was a wonderful American documentary film, and Robson happily, after some years of oblivion, was rehabilitated. And I discovered after, from the lips of the horse mouth, from the horse mouth, from his son, what was the reason to come that time? One of the reasons. Because this time it was a splash of, first splash of anti-Semitism. And Solomon Michoel, great Jewish actor, was arrested. And he was afterwards, he was just killed. An Iron newspaper explained it like car accident. I've seen him on the stage when I came from Siberia as a TV milkman, as a King Lear. I think he was best King Lear what I've seen. And and other friends, Jewish intellectuals, were arrested and tortured afterwards. That's why in Robson, very courageously in this condition, because he could be killed himself by GPU agents. He was trying to do everything to save his friends. It was a very risky mission. So that's real story, not invented by me. So now, first of all, but Robson, as a singer, he resurrected one Russian army song, which was not performed for already some years of Stalin's time. Because while soldiers were recruiting, the girls were crying. They were not very enthusiastic that they are going to the war. That was the reason. And Robson resurrected this beautiful song, Polushko Poli, which means prairie, my prairie, something like this. And we called him Polushka Robson afterwards. It's a very tendent suffix in Russian. So this is a real ballad, documentary ballad about Paul Robson. And please, let's hear voice of Paul Robson. Please, Anthony. It's Polish Kapole in English and Russian.
This song was born in bondage when all Russia sang it together, even the barbed wire squealed out in chorus.
Полюшка, поле, песня родилась в неволе, и когда ее Россия пела, проволока колючая скрипела.
I grew up hungry, a foster child of the Cold War, but I hungered not so much for bread as I did for Paris, Rome, and New York.
Рос я голодный на войне такой холодной, голодал, жуя сухую корку по Парижу, Лондону, Нью-Йорку.
The rusty iron curtain divided us from the rest of the world. We heard not a sound, not an echo from outside. But New York itself landed in Moscow.
Занавес ржавый нависал над всей державой. Не было ни отзвука, ни эха, а Нью-Йорк, он сам в Москву приехал.
It was Paul, or as we called him, Polyushka Robson, that great basso, huge as a mountain of shining coal. Cautiously, gently, gently, this Afro-American hunk lifted his voice like a mighty elephant trunk.
Полюшка Робсон с черный терекон был ростом, нежно, осторожно, очень-очень, голосом, как хоботом, ворочал.
Someone asked, "Why do you sing Russian songs, my dear?" He smiled, "I have a close relative here." Who? Everyone's ears rose up all aframe. Робсон just laughed. You know, Пушкин is his name.
Рты все раскрыли. У меня есть родственник в России. Кто? Поднялись ушки на макушке. Робсон рассмеялся. Это Пушкин.
In our famous prison, Lubyanka, in our own true red Ku Klux Klanka, they lynched any poet with no reason. To have a conscience was treason.
В нашей знаменитой Лубянке, в нашей красной куклукс-кланке линчевали ни за что поэтов, дорогой ему страны советов. Робсон had read in newspaper that the great Jewish actor Михоэлс was killed in a car accident. But Robson was not blind. He knew that many Jewish intellectuals had been arrested as a spies, and among them another close friend, a poet, trying to save him, pretending to be naive. Robson asked all Soviet officials, where is the Itzik? Where I want to see my friend Itzik. Finally, Itzik, worn out completely by tortures of Lubyanka, was dressed up, washed, shaved, and brought directly from prison to Robson's luxurious hotel room. Itzik was emaciated, as if all the blood has been squeezed out of him. Why don't you eat something, Itzik? Robson asked, pointing to the silver bucket of the ice with the black caviar. Itzik answered with a sad smile, "Thank you, Paul. But believe me, I'm fed up with black caviar. They spoiled me with it too much. Don't you see how healthy and happy I am?" And white, while their voices spoke loudly of their mutual happiness, their hands spoke of quite different things. Being sure that their conversation is bugging, Robson scratched with a pencil on a scrap of paper, Mikoels, and placed there a large question mark. Itzik wrote two words, murdered Stalin. What about you, wrote Robson. Itzik drew his finger sharply across his throat, a gesture that does need translation. Afterwards, as they embraced, saying goodbye forever, Robson noticed that Itzik's cheeks were naturally red, Not in agreement with his prison camp eyes. Robinson had to wipe from his own face the greasy makeup which had been put on the Itzik's face by prison cosmetic specialists. They did everything they could to make their victim look happy. From then on, Robinson was followed by GPU agents. And when he returned to America, other rivals agents followed him. These so-called official patriots were destroying his baseball bats, the cars of Robson admirers going to his concert. This was the tragic destiny of Pushkin's close relative, Paul Robson.
How to get away from, without false notes, without carrots and sticks. How to get away from politics. In any time, in any condition, genius is always under suspicion.
Как жить без фальши? Как быть от политики подальше? Но в любом ведется поколение гении всегда на подозрении.
Robeson, forgive us. Hope has abandoned us, wiping her bitter tears. Perhaps she will return once again. Maybe.
Robeson, прости нас, что надежда с нами распростилась, вытирая слезы виновата. Может быть, вернется к нам когда-то.
You sang long ago in Russian, how vast is our dear land, but now Russia shrinks, shrinks. God save us from even worse.
Пел ты, рыдая, широка страна моя родная. Она все уже, уже, уже. Господь, Бог, спаси, чтоб не случилось хуже.
Maidens are crying. Their young soldiers return in zinc coffins. Can it be that all the world will become an enormous Chechnya?
Девушки плачут. Их парней в гробы из цинка прячут. Неужели подожжен войною станет мир одной большой Чеченею?
There is no red army now, and all our boys are dying without reason. But maybe every time and everywhere there is no reasonable death.
Армии съежились цветы твои от боли, замерзают и цветы, и слезы. Эх, кабы на цветы, да не мороз. Полюшка Робсон, your voice still brave, your bus so easily opens your grave, your Russian songs were not sung in vain, and your spirit soars on, singing again.
Now let's all sing together louder, sing with us our battle song united. Полюшка, Polska szeroka wolie, jedący pokoń geroi, ech, ta krasnej armii geroi.
Could you give us possibility to read three poems more? Okay? Are you? Do you have strength? Okay. What do you permit us? That man responsible. You never will invite me next time. because I don't know word schedule. It's one of the latest poems. Now, I will take published on one book, compiled by my own wife. I never, in my best dream, could suppose what she could choose. 512 pages of good poetry. I was very surprised. I was expecting something 30 pages. Okay, so this is one. I have a good news for all specialists in Russian literature. There is one city of Perm. It's a very cultural city. It's a provincial. But we have in Moscow too much concentration of many best theaters, museum, but Perm is something special. And they are Pasternak, in Dr. Zhivago wrote his, he described how he came with his family to Yuryatin. Yuryatin was pseudonym of Perm, and he described Perm very scrupulously. And new young governor, who is not writer, not poet. Oh, no, it's not true, absolutely. He wrote a book of short stories. That's true, surprisingly. He has one idea to give to one the Perm 2, its special station, name Yuryatin, to transform novel into reality, into they are going to build giant cultural center named after Pasternak, and to have a symposium, poetry readings, and so on. It's a great idea. And one, I'm visiting very often Perm. But once we were sitting in Russia, it's like I feel like in America, because it was absolutely changed all schedule of flights. People was lying down on the floors like something in America sometimes happens. And we heard very strange announcement by radio. It's one of my newest poems. 489, one moment. Okay. You're first. It's special poem. Passenger Nikanorov. It's very current. You.
Yes. At the airport, on the border of Europe, Asia, destroying everybody's mood, glumly muffling the clinking teaspoons, the invisible female announcer, annoyingly polite, drilled into the PA. Passenger Nikanorov. Passenger Nikanorov. Passenger Nikanorov, departing to Барнаул.
В перском аэропорте настроение всем портя, хмуро вторгнувшись в гул, кто-то из контролеров, нудный выказав норов, микрофон затянул. Пассажир Никаноров, пассажир Никаноров, пассажир Никаноров, вылетающий на Барнаул.
Никаноров was hiding. He masterminded this siege, cunningly evaporating like the Cheshire Cat, probably drinking 9% beer called Diesel, followed by 40% vodka chasers, while chewing finger sandwiches, embracing half of Russia in the buffet.
Никаноров скрывался, хитро он оставался невидимкой в гульбе. Вряд ли был олигархом, может, бомжем-огарком, непонятным себе. Может быть, на коробках и мешках прикорнул. Гражданин Никаноров. No. It's your. I stole your text. That's your.
He was neither an oligarch nor a bum, just savagely alone. Perhaps he just took a sweet nap on a hill of sacks and boxes, this undiscovered citizen Nicanorov, departing to Барнаул.
Может быть, на коробках и мешках прикорну, гражданин Никанор, вылетающий на Барнаул.
Perhaps he was wallowing like a pig in a warm, friendly puddle, seeing in his sweet dreams an endless trough filled with infinite slop, this mysterious citizen Nicanorov flying to Барнаул.
Может, в луже, как Боров, где-то он храпанул, гражданин Никаноров, вылетающий на Барнаул.
Perhaps he was a soldier and unpatriotically deserted, trying to hide from the sounds of musical pea soup in the military barracks, and found a temporary hideout from the military patrol only in the differently aromatic ladies' room.
Может, он дезертирил ото всех дедовщин, прячась в женском сортире от военных мужчин.
And perhaps, more frightening than all verdicts and the black pupils of rifle barrels, comes the voice full of motherland's reproach, Citizen Nicanorov, Citizen Nicanorov, Citizen Nicanorov, departing to Барнаул.
И страшней приговоров, и зрачков черных дул, голос полный укоров, гражданин Никаноров, гражданин Никаноров, гражданин Никаноров, вылетающий на Барнаул.
And something more lethal than a bullet burns into my chest. What did he hope to find in that damned Барнаул, this damned citizen Nicanorov? What kind of evil joke was he playing with us? Through what hole or crack did he slink out, this slithering citizen Nicanorov, departing to Барнаул?
И смертельные пули у меня жжет груди. Что он мог в Барнауле Никаноров найти? Бросил нас на кого он? Скуку, пьяни, разгул, гражданин Никаноров, вылетающий на Барнаул.
Perhaps, hopelessly dejected, he, a former veteran, a hero of an unheroic war, protesting against a new one, he, almost transparent after hunger strikes, has been forgotten by dear motherland.
Может. Может, мертвенно-мрачный совсоюза герой, с голодовок прозрачный, позабыт он страной.
Perhaps, somewhere in desperation, in a secret dark corner, he hanged himself, now no longer swinging on a taut soldier's belt.
Может, где-то отчаясь, в потайном уголке он висит, не качаясь, на тугом ремешке.
Has he vanished like an orphan? And I feel such icy horror, as if that steely voice in the PA slashed my guts, and I scream soundlessly, like in a bad dream. My voice muffled by the vastness of Russia. Citizen Nicanorov, Citizen Nicanorov, Citizen Nicanorov, departing for Барнаул.
Сгинул, как сиротинка, и такая жутинка, будто голос, как финка, по кишкам полоснул, хоть кричи, караул! В глушь российских просторов, гражданин Никанор, гражданин Никанор, гражданин Никанор, вылетающий на Барнаул.
I have limit 2 points. Now
short story. I have some friends of my poetry. They call you America famous by your gynecologists, and we are famous, Russia is famous by their Yevtushenkologists. So that's an association of Yevtushenko, they are the specialists in Yevtushenko war. You have one here in Chicago, is an engineer, Mark Levin, who organized in very difficult times for me and for many Russian intellectuals during dissident trials. He organized first museum in his private apartment in Leningrad. He moved to America. He brought all his stuff here, and he opened Museum of Yevtushenko in Chicago. It does exist. Even Chicago Tribune once wrote about this charming gentleman full of enthusiasm, and I don't know why Oyer estimated me so much, he's here.
Thank you, Zhenya.
So one of some of these two gynecologists, sometimes they, I don't check, don't take care of my archives. I say, I have no time for it. So, but they sometimes, they give me information, absolutely unexpected facts, which I didn't know. For instance, they, not long ago, I heard something from Moscow jazz man that Paul McCartney somewhere mentioned something about me, but it was very foggy. And they just brought me evidence. Paul McCartney wrote a big anthology of peace, some peace, in his memoirs. It's kind of interview form, memoirs in form of interview. He was remembering his first trip to Beatles to the continental Europe. They were visiting with their moms, first time abroad with them. And paradoxically, I was presented in Rome in 1964 at their concert. I didn't know that before even that concert, they, before to open curtain, they were reading my poem for encourage them for a performance. So how it happened? One girl, girlfriend of Paul McCartney, she gave him my first poetry book, Zeman Junction, which was published by Penguin in 1961, to Paul. Paul liked it very much. He recited it to his friends. They liked it very much. And first concert was very successful after reading, when they recited it, just before curtain was open. And so when they were traveling, they were always, it was their tradition. They were opening my book, they were reading one my poem. So I was traveling with them, as I, you know. And I discovered it, but it's better later than that. So I wrote this poem, a ballad about Fifth Beatle, or probably shorter, Fifth Beatle. Okay, so, Anthony, are you ready? Do you follow me as I'm telling? Anthony,
hi.
You remember our agreement? I will make gesture, and please, all of you, you are people of different generations, but everybody knows at least three verses which I use, this I quoted as a musical quotation. So help us, because we are not great singers. We are not, couldn't be Pavarotti's without you, but with you, it could be mighty chorus. Repeat with us these three lines. We are living in the yellow submarine. Okay, good, remember, it's three times repeated. Okay, help us, support us. I'm your local poet. Humanity is village, support your local poet. Okay.
In the yellow submarine, in the yellow submarine, four mischievous English boys were joyfully cooking sailor's slop, mixing up the devil knows what, adding into their mess kits ocean foam.
Желтой субмарине, в желтой субмарине, четверо мальчишек англичан, в плотский суп варили, черти что творили, подливая в миски океан.
So it was a jolly, cunning, beautiful creation of that soup from boiling musical notes. And the girls' bras and even their panties, like white seagulls, flew to the stage.
Желтый суп, в общем, шло не глупо. Сотворение супа из кипящих музыкальных нот. И летели чайками лифчики отчаянно. И бросались трусики в полет. We live.
We all live in the yellow submarine. Yellow submarine. Yellow submarine. We all live in the yellow submarine. Yellow submarine, yellow submarine.
The roaring of the rockets was in the rock. The Beatles showed all of Europe that rock could be a prophet. Their Liverpudlian mums, abroad for the first time, took to the concerts their needles and spools, knitting sweaters for their boys.
Рык ракет был в роке. Битлы всей Европе доказали то, что рок пророк. Спицы взяв шпульки, мамы ливерпульки свитера вязали им под рок.
Ringo Starr, John Lennon, almost on their knees, begged the hall, be kind to us. We don't need your cries of joy so much. Our moms so want to hear us, that's all.
Ringo Starr, John Lennon, чуть не на коленях, умоляли зал, be kind to us. Нам не надо столько воплей и восторга, мамы.
The Liverpudlian heroes were not heard, but they had to be polite anyway. If you are already the idol, my dear, have patience under the yoke of admirers.
Но ливерпульчане словом непечатным не посмели обижать людей. Если уж ты идол, то терпи под игом обожателей.
We all live in the yellow submarine, yellow submarine, yellow submarine. We live in the yellow submarine, yellow submarine, yellow submarine.
And Paul McCartney's girlfriend with beetleish red hair bangs, mad about my poem Zima Junction, gave her lover my first English book as a gift.
Одна девчонка, битловская челка, от стихов моих сходя с ума, начитавшись в волю, подарила полю по-английски станцию «Зима».
Paul McCartney began to find on the map with his curious pen my little junction, where once in the Siberian forest, tiger, I was born like some unexpected horseradish.
Стал искать Маккартни на всемирной карте станцию мою карандашом, где я уродился, как в тайге редиска, и купался в речке нагишом.
I'm hurt a little bit that I was their fifth beetle, but invisible. Not so bad, but it's a pity that I didn't even have a chance to sing with them shoulder to shoulder. Now it's my turn.
Вот что мне обидно. Вроде пятым битлом по гастролям с ним ездил я. Да вот не успели, вместе мы не спели. Но сегодня очередь моя. We live in
the yellow submarine. Yellow submarine, yellow submarine, yellow submarine. We live in the yellow submarine. Yellow submarine, yellow submarine.
Once, many years later, I embraced Yoko Ono over the grave of John Lennon in Central Park. There, yellow submarine under the earth, tunneled with her nose to John's grave and huddled with his coffin.
Я во время Оно обнял Йоко Оно над могилой Джона в городе Нью-Йорк. Носом субмарина к Джону ход прорыла и прижалась к гробу, где он лег.
Angels will never disclose where the Beatles' moms today are knitting sweaters for them again. For moms, sons are more important than the glory of their sons. Our moms so want to hear us, that's all.
Ангелы не скажут, где сегодня вяжут мамы, нам над спицами склонясь. Что ж не им право, чем любая слава? Мамы так хотят послушать нас.
Our moms know, all our graves are scars on the face of our common mother earth. In the yellow submarine, in the yellow submarine, in the yellow submarine, the Beatles and I found each other forever.
Знают наши мамы, все могилы, шрамы нашей общей матери земли в желтой субмарине, в желтой субмарине, в желтой субмарине навсегда друг друга мы нашли. We built the yellow submarine, yellow submarine, yellow submarine. We all built the yellow submarine, yellow submarine, yellow submarine.
Thank you. So, last poem of this reading. Not long ago, a couple of years ago, I got a letter from Israel. One father, he asked my permission if he could to give to his son name Babi Yar. And very interesting explanation. He said, I'm afraid that people doesn't like. Many people today, unfortunately, don't like to remember anything about atrocity. And sometimes they are saying, oh, they were not involved in it. So why they have to suffer listening about it, to read books about it. And I just asking your permission to give my son name Babi Yar, because I would like, if people who doesn't know what is Babi Yar, will ask what it means, and he will explain each time. I gave him this permission. Poem was written when it was a conspiracy of the side around Babi Yar in our press. When I published, it was not only, you know, I was people who exaggerated my courage. I wrote. To write it was easy. To publish it was uneasy. And I have one poem dedicated to editor who published it. He knew. He said to me that he will be fired. He even called. He said, it has to be family decision. He called up his wife. She came. She was a mighty Russian woman with a wrestler's shoulder, former nurse who saved many hundreds of wounded people from the battlefield during Second World War. So she came into his office. I was sitting on the tip of chair in the corridor waiting for their decision, family decision. They came both embracing each other. And looking at me and a little bit smiling, she said, and she was, her eyes were a little bit wet. And she said to me, don't worry, Zhenya, we decided to be fired. It was great, unforgettable. I think what they were heroes of Babi Yar. It was more dangerous for them. And I just admire these people, and I included in my latest book poem dedicated to this couple. And generally, you know, I believed more in our people, Russian, after all, because I got incredible national support of this poem. Not only, but it was supported by Jews, but many people, workers, students, even, it was not so-called a very dangerous situation, I don't know, probably could happen something, but, you know, I just, Russian university basketball team was with me. They were with me like bodyguards during 1 month. It was just incredible support, really. And this is was, it was another discovery for me, of my people, of potentiality of Russian people. So in the afterwards I was, but of course the chauvinists attacked me. They were trying to find Jewish blood in me, because of their chicken minds, they could not understand if one man, other nationality, could feel pain of other nation like his own. That's why they are already punished by God, because they don't deserve name of to be named as human beings. And it was a call, unexpected call. We were sitting in the mom's room with my wife, and we were playing cards. Ruskoe duraka играли, Russian fool. We were playing. It was a call, and my wife took through very big, very angry the phone. She said, what the people now are living around us? One arrogant man calling us now and calling himself Shostakovich, because it was impossible to imagine. But the call was repeated. She became pale, said, it seems to me it's him. And Shostakovich very politely asked me, dear, in very, high-flowing Russian, St. Petersburg in Russian. He asked me, Дорогой Евгений Александрович, dear Евгений Александрович, I like your poem so much. You just expressed my feelings. I hope the feelings of many Russians. And please, could you be so kind? Give me permission to compose music for you. I don't remember, honestly, what I was mumbling to him. Of course, I was on the heaven. And when I gave him permission, he said, do you have a little bit probably free time now? I said, yes, of course. He said, okay, could you come over? Because music is ready. It was first performance. It was beginning, it was the first part of, it was only music for Babi Yar at that time. It was not yet symphony, it was sonata, kind of sonata. But it was great, and afterwards I brought him some my new book, and very soon he created 13 symphony, which is a God's gift for my life. And I'm very happy that I helped to the greatest composer of 20th century to write such immortal piece. That's probably even to, it's, you could be even born for it, for such great alarm. So I will read this poem which played a great role in my own life. Anyway, it helped Shostakovich to write his 13th symphony and to create finally monument over the Babi Yar. Над Бабьим Яром памятников нет. Крутой обрыв, как грубое надгробие. Мне страшно, Мне сегодня столько лет, как самому еврейскому народу. No monument stands over Babi Yar, a drop sheer as a crude gravestone. I'm afraid today I am as old in years as all the Jewish people. Мне кажется, сейчас я иудей, вот я бреду по древнему Египту, а вот я на кресте распятый гибну, и до сих пор на мне следы гвоздей. Now I seem to be a Jew. Here I plod through ancient Egypt. Here I perish crucified on the cross. And to this day I bear the scars of nails. I seem to be Dreyfus. The Philistine is both informer and judge. I am behind bars, beset on every side, hounded, spat on, slandered, squealing, dainty ladies in flounced Brussels lace stick their parasols into my face. I seem to be then a young boy in Белосток. Мне кажется, я мальчик в Белостоке. Кровь льется, растекаясь пополам. Бесчинствуют вожди трактирной стойки и пахнут водкой с луком пополам. Я сапогом отброшен и бессилен. Напрасно я погромщиков молю под гогот. Пей, жидов, спасай Россию! Насилует лобазник мать. Мою. I seem to be then a young boy in Белосток. Blood runs spilling over the floors. The barroom rabble rousers give off a stench of vodka and onion. A boot kicks me aside. Helpless. In vain I plead with these pogrom bullies while they jeer and shout, beat the Yids! Save Mother Russia! Some grain marketeer beats up my mother. Oh, my Russian people, I know you are your international to the core. But those with unclean hands have often made a jingle of your purest name. I know the goodness of my land. How vile these anti-Semites, without a qualm, they pompously called themselves the Union of the Russian people. Read this piece. I seem to be
Anne Frank, transparent as a branch in April, and I love and have no need of phrases. My need is that we gaze into each other. How little we can see or smell. We are denied the leaves, we are denied the sky, yet we can do so much tenderly. Embrace each other in a darkened room. They are coming here. Be not afraid. Those are the booming sounds of spring. Spring is coming here. Come then to me. Quick, give me your lips. Are they smashing down the door? No, it's the ice breaking.
The wild grasses rustle over Babi Yar. The trees look ominous, like judges. Here, all things scream silently, and baring my head, slowly I feel myself turning gray.
And I, myself, I'm one massive, soundless scream about the thousand buried here. I am each old man here shot dead. I am every child here shot dead. Nothing in me shall ever forget the international let it thunder when the last anti-Semite on earth is buried forever. Я каждый здесь расстрелянный старик. Я каждый здесь расстрелянный ребенок. Ничто во мне про это не забудет. Интернационал пусть прогремит, когда навеки похоронен будет последний на земле антисемит. In my blood, there is no Jewish blood, but in their callous rage, all anti-Semites must hate me now as a Jew. For that reason, I'm a true Russian. Еврейской крови нет в крови моей, но ненавистен злобой заскорузлой. Я всем антисемитам, как еврей. И потому я настоящий русский. Спасибо. Спасибо.